Most of you probably know that back when I was in high school, what I really wanted to do was practice law. I wanted to become a lawyer, and really the reasons for this weren't anything upstanding. I didn't want to become a criminal prosecutor or a defense attorney, you know, stand up for the little guy, anything like that. I wanted to practice corporate law. I wanted to take the screws to people and get as much money out of them as I could, because I figured that, you know what, I wanted a comfortable lifestyle. I wanted to be able to see something and to be able to buy it. I wanted to be able to feel successful, to feel powerful, to be able to rise up the ranks and see all these great things happen. As you can tell, I did not become a lawyer. But I think that most of us, like I was back in high school, and even at times today, most of us are looking for meaning and purpose in our life. Most of us want to know what is there in life that makes life worth living. So what do? We try to make ourselves feel good. We go around and we say, I want as much money as I can get, because if I have money, then I'm going to be happy because nothing will be beyond my reach. Or we say, you know what, I want to be successful. If I can just get this job off the ground, this little enterprise off the ground, if I can rise up the ranks of the corporate ladder and be successful and make something of myself, that is going to make me happy. Look for the next promotion, striving, working harder. Some people might say, well, you know what, if this life is what there is, I just want to feel good. I just want to make the most out of everything. And so if it makes me happy, if it makes me feel good, that must just be the purpose of life. I'm going to just reach out there and try to seize all the pleasures of life by the shoulder. Other people might be saying, well, that's great. You know, you're talking about money, you're talking about success, all of this stuff. That's not even on my radar, because I wake up each morning and the only thing on my mind is my roof going to stay over my head today? Am I going to have enough food on the table today to be able to feed myself and my children? And see, for some people, the purpose of life, the meaning of life, it's all about survival. It's just about getting through the next day. How can I do this? Can I scrape up enough clean water to be able to drink and live as people around the world end up having to do? See, whether you find your meaning and your purpose in life in extravagance and trying to be great and trying to make life the greatest thing that you can find, or whether it is that life is something that has challenged you and you say the whole purpose of life is just to get through today and get to tomorrow. When you look at life that way, it may work for a time, but eventually you find an emptiness there. You find an emptiness. Is this all that life is? What's the point? As the Rolling Stones wrote in one of their famous songs, it seems like no matter how hard we try, we can't get no satisfaction. We might get it for a little bit, but we try and we try and we try, but we can't get no satisfaction. Last week, we talked about a full eternity. We said that the empty tomb is a promise of a full eternity. But there was a question that was left open there. And the question was this: it's great that there is an eternity waiting for me if I follow Jesus, if I put my trust in him. But what about right now? What is the point of today? And so we might be tempted to think, well, you know what, if I can do the bare minimum and get myself into this full eternity you talked about and enjoy this full eternity, then I'm just going to enjoy life and do whatever I can to make it feel like there's some kind of purpose, like there's some kind of point, like it feels good enough to me. But I want you to know today that rather than looking forward to this full eternity and thinking that your life has to be empty and that your life is worthless or meaningless, or even if you're here today and you haven't ascribed to thinking, you know what, yes, I trust in Jesus. I want a full eternity. Let me tell you that your life does not have to be empty, that you can have a full life. See, Jesus can do something now. Last week, we talked about the resurrection, and we talked about the disciples' reaction to that and what it means for us today. And I want to go back a little bit, just briefly here, and talk about the roller coaster that the disciples must have been on. You know, we talked Palm Sunday about how maybe the crowds and even some of the disciples, as they looked at Jesus marching in on a donkey, marching into Jerusalem, they had different plans for him than he had. They thought he was someone else. And so he corrects them. He says, yeah, the Son of Man is going to be lifted up. And then 3 days later, he's going to rise from the grave. And they're all like, whoa, wait a second. No, you're supposed to stay with us. What's going on? And next thing you know, he's being arrested and he's being beaten and nailed to a cross, and then he dies. And the disciples are going, my goodness, like first he tells us that he's not going to save us from Roman rule and that he's saving us another way, and then he's dead. And they're all afraid and they're not sure what's happening. Then they find out that the tomb is empty, that Jesus has risen again, and he passes through the wall and he shows himself to them. And then for 40 days, he spends time teaching them and showing himself to 500 other people who all see that Jesus is here. And then he says a few parting words, and what does he do? He basically says, see you later, and goes back up to heaven. So then the disciples, they go back to Jerusalem, and obediently and humbly, they're waiting and praying in Jerusalem. And then we come to Acts chapter 2. If you've got your Bible here today, you can go ahead and turn there with me, Acts chapter 2. If you have a mobile device and you prefer to use that, or you'd like to be able to follow along with today's message and save your own notes, you can go to abundantsprings.church/notes, and that's going to take you right to today's message in the YouVersion app, or give you a link to be able to buy that, or not buy that, it's free to download that. But I just invite you to read this with me. Here's what we read. When the day of Pentecost arrived, they were all together in one place. And suddenly there came from heaven a sound like a mighty rushing wind, and it filled the entire house where they were sitting. And divided tongues as a fire appeared to them and rested on each of them. And they were all filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance. Now there were dwelling in Jerusalem Jews, devout men from every nation under heaven. And at this sound, the multitude came together, and they were bewildered, because each one was hearing them speak in his own language. And they were amazed and astonished, saying, are not all these who are speaking Galileans? And how is it that we hear, each of us, in his own native language, Parthians and Medes and Elamites and residents of Mesopotamia, Judea and Cappadocia, Pontus and Asia, Phrygia and Pamphylia, Egypt and the parts of Libya belonging to Cyrene, and visitors from Rome, both Jews and proselytes, Cretans and Arabians? We hear them telling in our own tongues the mighty works of God. And all were amazed and perplexed, saying to one another, what does this mean? But others mocking said, they are filled with new wine. There they were. And they're praying, and this miraculous thing happens. They're praying, and then these tongues of fire fall on their head, and then they're speaking in other languages, and everyone hears the noise. There's people from all around the world, the known world at the time, in Jerusalem, and they hear the noise in the upper room, and they all come running to see what it is, and they're amazed, not only because they hear people speaking in their own languages, but because of who's doing the speaking. They say, aren't these Galileans? We might say, well, what does it matter if they're Galileans? Because Galileans were uneducated. Galileans were rough and tumble guys. And so they're going, wait a second. No. These guys are speaking in all these languages. What's going on? And everyone's hearing the works of God spoken to them. And then something interesting happens. And to really see the importance of this, we need to understand who this guy named Peter is. And if you've spent much time in the Gospels, that's the first four books of the New Testament, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, where these various authors, they write about the life of Jesus and his disciples. When we look at Peter, we see a guy who was quick to speak or to jump into action, but then he'd kind of just get left there, floundering. I think that when I read the Gospels, I see Peter with his foot in his mouth more than on the ground. You know, he's just one of those guys, and he's a guy that runs away, but sometimes runs forward, and you never know what's going to happen with Peter. The only thing you know is that he's going to do something wrong. But then we see this, if you continue along in verse 14. But Peter, standing with the 11, lifted up his voice and addressed them, "Men of Judea and all who dwell in Jerusalem, let this be known to you and give ear to my words. For these people are not drunk as you suppose, since it is only the third hour of the day," that's 9 o'clock in the morning. "But this is what was uttered through the prophet Joel. And in the last days it shall be, God declares, that I will pour out my spirit on all flesh, and your sons and your daughters shall prophesy, and your young men shall see visions, and your old men shall dream dreams. Even on my male servants and female servants, in those days I will pour out my spirit, and they shall prophesy. I will show wonders in the heavens above and signs on the earth below, blood and fire and vapor of smoke. The sun shall be turned to darkness and the moon to blood. Before the day of the Lord comes, the great and magnificent day, and it shall come to pass that everyone who calls upon the name of the Lord shall be saved." So there's Peter, and this great thing has happened, and people are questioning it, and some people are jeering it at them, saying, oh, they're drunk. And then Peter stands up, and he gives this inspired speech from God with great boldness and with great courage. And I can just imagine the guys that knew Peter going, "What? Is that Peter saying that?" See, it's an amazing thing that because of the Holy Spirit, when the Holy Spirit came on Peter, there was this shift in the way that Peter was able to speak and who Peter was. Now, that's not to say that Peter from that time on was this perfect guy. He still messed up. We all still mess up. But the Holy Spirit gave him strength, and the Holy Spirit gave him the words to speak and the courage to speak those words. And so you might be saying, well, that's great. Okay, so the Holy Spirit comes and does this weird thing, and people are speaking in these weird languages, and then there's Peter, and he stands up, and he tells everybody this awesome thing and talks about this prophecy that Jeremiah had done. So what does this mean? What happened because of this? So let's look at the outcome of this event. Turn in your Bible to verse 37. This is what we read. "Now when they heard this, they were cut to the heart and said to Peter and to the rest of the apostles, 'Brothers, what shall we do?' And Peter said to them, 'Repent, be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of your sins, and you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit.'" And I don't think this next part is on your slides, but I want to read it to you. "For the promise is for you and for your children and for all who are far off, everyone whom the Lord our God calls to himself." That's great, Pastor Stephen. So you've shared with us this interesting story about the Holy Spirit coming and filling these people up, and they're speaking weird language. But what on earth does this have to do with my life? What on earth does this have to do with an empty life and filling it up with anything? And so one more Bible passage. Turn back to Acts chapter 1, verse 6 through 8, and this is what we see. "So when they," this is the disciples and Jesus, "had come together, they asked Jesus, 'Lord, will you at this time restore the kingdom to Israel?'" They still haven't totally gotten it through their heads what he is doing. "And he said to them, 'It is not for you to know times or seasons that the Father has fixed by his own authority.'" Listen to this. "But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and in all Judea and Samaria and to the end of the earth." And then he rose back up to heaven. Will you join me in praying this morning? Heavenly Father, I thank you that we can look to you for purpose and to be filled with something greater. Lord, today, whatever we're struggling with, whatever it is, I ask that each person here will feel your Holy Spirit's presence, Lord God, that your Holy Spirit will be tugging the heartstrings that need to be tugged and getting us ready to receive what you have to speak to us this morning. Lord, take these feeble human words that I'm about to speak and make them something worthwhile through the power of your Spirit, I pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Jesus told the disciples that this was going to happen. He told them, wait, and I'm going to send the helper to you. And the Holy Spirit, when he comes on you, he's going to give you power. And then you're going to go and you're going to do this thing. You're going to be my witnesses in Jerusalem and Judea and Samaria and to the ends of the earth. But notice that what we read there, that Peter said, he said, this gift, this Holy Spirit, it's not just for these people here in this room, but that it's for everyone who will call on the name of the Lord from this time forward. This isn't just an isolated event, but this is something for all people who would believe in Jesus Christ. And so what we see is from this passage, Jesus saying, an empty life is made full of purpose when you follow Jesus. An empty life is made full of purpose when you follow Jesus. What is the purpose? What's the purpose? Well, the purpose is to be his witnesses in your neighborhood, in your town, in your nation, and in this world. The purpose is to share the story of what Jesus did because of his great love for all of us and to show his love to the world. That is the purpose. That is the mission. And it's going to look different for different people. But that is the purpose and the mission that you were given. And it seems like a scary one. You might be thinking, how on earth is this going to happen? I'm just me. This is such a big thing. I mean, sharing the good news with people? Doing what God is calling me into? I don't know if I can do this. But let me tell you today that God made you with talents and abilities that are perfect for the purpose that he has for you. God made you with talents and abilities that are perfect for the purpose that he has for you. See, an empty life is made full of purpose when you follow Jesus. But he's not just leaving you there saying, here's your purpose, now go and do it. He's saying, I have given you what you need to fulfill the purpose that I have given you. I've given you what you need. And so maybe you're here and you don't even realize that you have the gifts that you have. You might be thinking, no, I don't have gifts. Like, Jesus can't use me because I don't have anything for him to use. I'm a failure. Everything I put my hand to turns brown, dies. What am I supposed to do? But listen, you may have gifts and abilities and talents that God has given you that are laying dormant that you don't even know about. Or maybe this, maybe your weaknesses are actually your greatest strengths. Sounds a little depressing when you first think about that. But what if that thing that you say, my greatest weakness is that I struggle with anger? What if God could use that anger, that difficulty that you've been struggling with, and whether it's through you overcoming it or whether it's just you walking onward faithfully towards God despite of it, if that weakness actually became your great strength as you began to work in whatever it is that God has for you? You might say, Pastor Stephen, you don't know the hurt that's in my heart. I've been abused and mistreated and misused, and I can't take it anymore. My heart breaks when I hear of people that have had that kind of thing go on in their lives, especially when they talk about being children and having those things happen. But can I tell you that those things don't have to be the things that hold you back, but they can actually be the things that propel you forward. They can be the things that make you strong. They can be the things that give you what you need for the purpose that God has placed in front of you. And I understand if you don't believe me right now when I say that. You might be thinking, you don't know how deep down that hurt, that pain, that loss, that sin of mine, whatever it is, that weakness of mine goes. You don't know. I can't get over this. And let me just tell you that with God, all things are possible. All things are possible. And maybe he's not calling you to get over that. I don't think that God looks at people that have suffered abuse and says, get over it. I think that he says, you're my child, and you have a purpose despite of that. And in fact, you have a purpose that's going to utilize that in your life. Furthermore, whatever you lack, the Holy Spirit's going to give you what you need. The Holy Spirit will give you the boldness that you need. I talk to people all the time and they say, I love the idea of going out and doing this, that, or the other thing, but I'm afraid. Later on in Acts, we see that the disciples were afraid. They'd been threatened. They'd been thrown in prison. And so they begin to pray and they say, Holy Spirit, come and give us boldness. And guess what he does? He came and he gave them boldness. He strengthened them. The Holy Spirit gives us the abilities that we need. He gives us the power and the strength that we need to go forward into the calling that he has on our lives. But you know, there's another group of people here. And there's that group of people that says, you know, I felt like God is calling me into something, but I know what my strengths are. And my strengths don't make any sense for what God is calling me into. I'm really good at this thing over here, but he wants me to go over here. I don't get it. And so there's something wrong because God hasn't given me the strengths that I need to go over here. He's given me the ones for over here, but he's calling me over there. I know how you feel. It was interesting once I decided, once God decided the lawyer was not the thing that was in front of me, that it was actually going and doing ministry. I had a strong sense that for me it was going to be leading a church or doing missions work, and I couldn't quite figure out, okay, so I play guitar and I sing. And everywhere that I would go, even during Bible college, I would be speaking to leaders and be talking about my call, and they'd be like, you're going to be a great worship pastor. I'd be like, but that's not what God's calling me to. Stop it. Like, there were actually times where I said, God, why did you make it so I can play guitar and sing? Because now everybody thinks that all I can do is go over here when really you've called me over here. And I couldn't figure it out, and it was so frustrating. And so I get you, if you're feeling like my talents, my giftings are over here, and everyone says I need to stay over here, but God is calling me here, and I don't see the connection, and I don't know how I'm going to move forward into what he has for me. Listen, you can. Because he's going to gift you perfectly. God made you with talents and abilities perfect for the purpose that he has made you for. An empty life is full of purpose when you follow Jesus. You're not lacking purpose when you follow him. You have a purpose ahead of you. See, Jesus made you unique and gifted you uniquely for unique purposes. Did you hear a word there? Unique. Jesus made you unique and gifted you uniquely for unique purposes. What that means is even if your giftings aren't what you think or what normal people would need for over here, maybe he's saying that he doesn't need normal. Maybe he's saying that's a unique purpose and you're a unique person and this is a unique gifting for that unique place, so get over to your unique position before I uniquely kick your butt. God does have a plan for you. You don't have to empty life. He has something great, a full life for you. And so I want you right now just to imagine living your life with a purpose that goes beyond what you want, beyond yourself, beyond just trying to accumulate, beyond just trying to survive, beyond just trying to experience all the world has to experience, and instead a purpose that will echo on through eternity, a purpose that will affect generations from you, even when you say there's absolutely nothing that is changing here, a purpose that fulfills you deeply because suddenly you are doing the thing that you were designed to do. Doesn't that sound like a life that is worth living? As opposed to scrambling around from one emotional high to the next, trying to find the next great thing to fill the void in your life. See, an empty life is made full of purpose when you follow Jesus. And not just when you follow Jesus as in I prayed a prayer, but when you actually one foot in front of the other, follow Jesus into what he's got for you. It's interesting, this whole thing of the selfishness surrounding myself wanting to become a lawyer, and then God pushed me out of that, and he's like, no, you're going into ministry. And then I was wrestling with, why aren't my giftings aligning with the way that God is leading me? And then suddenly this little place called Pincher Creek popped up on my radar, and lo and behold, it worked out very well to be able to lead music and be able to do what God called me into. See, God gifts us for the role that he has for us to play. And it doesn't always make sense, but he does it. God made you unique and gifted you uniquely for unique purposes. He made you with talents and abilities that are perfect that he has for you. An empty life is made full of purpose when you follow Jesus. And so here's what I have for you to do this week. If you're saying, yes, I want to have something beyond this emptiness. I want not only a full eternity, but I want a full life. Then here's my one thing I want for you today. I want you to invite Jesus to fill your life. And so if you're here today or you're watching the video online or listening to our podcast and you're thinking, I want this full life. And how do I follow this Jesus? Let me tell you, the first step is to believe in your heart that Jesus is God and that he did what he said in the Bible here, that he died on the cross, that he rose again for you, and that because of him, you are forgiven. If you can believe in that, if you can believe that he is risen again, victorious over death, and if you say, I want to commit my life to one step after the other, following the principles that Jesus wants me to live by, then you found Jesus. And so in just a moment, we're going to pray a prayer to help you to thank God for what he's done and to commit yourself to him. But just for a moment, I want to talk to those who maybe you're a new Christian. Maybe you're not sure what comes next. Can I just encourage you, get in contact with your local church, whether you're somewhere else or whether you're here and you're just like, I want the next step. Talk to one of us with the blue tag and we're going to help get a Bible in your hand if you don't have one and get you connected with a mentor if that can help you. Because it's so important to continue to grow your faith. And then if you're here and you're like, listen, this is all old hat. I read my Bible. I pray. I follow Jesus. Is there anything for me? Because I still feel empty. Do you sit here and you say, I don't feel like I have purpose? Maybe you're thinking, I don't know what my purpose is. Can I just share with you that Jesus has told us all what our purpose is, and it's going to look different each person, but our main purpose here on the earth is to love God and to love our neighbors as ourselves and to be God's witnesses here and out there. That's your purpose. Love and witness. Share the good news of Jesus Christ. Pastor Stephen, you say that, but I haven't been able to find my... Really? Love your neighbor, love God, share the good news of Jesus. I'm afraid. Isn't that what it comes down to so often? I'm afraid. I don't know what to say. Let the Holy Spirit speak into your life. Invite Jesus to fill your life and invite the Holy Spirit to come into your life and begin to empower you and embolden you. Ask for wisdom and believe that you have received it. When you see a situation and you're like, I should be speaking life into the situation. Just quick prayer, Holy Spirit, speak to me so I can speak to them, and then do it. It is amazing how taking the risk of making a fool out of yourself can turn out to be the best thing you can do. And you may leave there thinking, I made a fool of myself, and that person leaves thinking they made a fool out of themselves. But then they say, but there was something about what they said. Something about what they said. Even if they get so mad that they're flipping you the bird and they're red-faced and telling you that you need to get out of there before they punch your teeth in. The fact that they're upset means that something got through to them. As long as you weren't like purposely antagonizing them. So humble yourself, pray and be obedient, and the Holy Spirit will empower you. And don't forget to come back the next couple of weeks here. Next week we're talking about money. We're talking about having an empty bank account. And this isn't going to be one of those messages that's like, you know what, if you give everything that you have to the church, God is going to bless you and he's going to give you 200 times what you gave. So that's not the way that we roll here. Okay. What this is that we believe very strongly that Jesus wants us to take care of what he has given us, and that he has shared with us ways that we can take steps to be what's called good stewards of what he has given us. That we can not be tight-fisted, but also not be frivolous, so that we can have to give what he calls us to give. So that's next week, and then the week after, we're talking about empty marriages and what Jesus has to speak to empty marriages and empty relationships, so that we can move forward in that. And so today, will you join me in praying? Heavenly Father, I thank you for each person here, those that have been Christians for a long time, and maybe they need that sense of purpose, that sense of calling, or they just need something deeper. They need that power and presence of your Holy Spirit on their lives. Lord, today, just work in us and renew us. Lord, for those that are new Christians and they're not sure, what do I do to follow Jesus? Lord, I ask that you will put them in touch with somebody who can guide them on their way, and that they won't be afraid of taking the next step towards becoming like you. And Jesus, today we also pray for all those that are wrestling with faith or that have just given their lives to Jesus just today. And Lord, I just ask that you'll continue to work in their hearts this morning. With everybody's heads still bowed, eyes still closed, I want to lead anyone here who is wanting to give their life to Jesus today, to commit themselves to him and say thank you for what he's done, to pray this simple prayer along with me. Heavenly Father, I know that I'm a sinner. I know that I don't deserve anything. But Lord, I know that I'm forgiven, because Jesus died and Jesus rose. Thank you for loving me. Thank you for forgiving me. I place my trust in Jesus and Jesus alone as my master and my savior. Help me not to live the way that I've been living, but help me to step forward into what you have for me to be living as from this time forward. In Jesus' name, amen. If you just prayed that prayer today, there's a blue card in the seat back in front of you. It says, I have decided to follow Jesus. And if you can fill that card out in the moment when the offering plate goes around, if you can place that card in the offering plate, you're going to have a few minutes to fill it out, so don't worry, you don't need to feel rushed. But when you put that card in the offering plate, we're going to make sure to follow up with you. Make sure that you can get connected with us and know what's next, and receive all the resources and mentorship that you need to go to the next step.